And welcome back after that delicious lunch. My name is Alexandra Gerstein, and I'm the curator of sculpture and decorative arts in the Courtauld Gallery. And my colleagues, Ayse, Tashkiran and Vanessa, Ewan, are both senior lecturers in movement at the Royal Central School of Speech and Drama. And the three of us will be delivering this over the next, I think we've got about 40 odd minutes altogether, including discussion. Our paper is called Embodied Perspectives on Sculpture, a Study in Interdisciplinary Research. And our paper addresses a collaboration that, can everyone hear me if I don't speak into the microphone? Okay. Our paper addresses a collaboration that took place between a curator and four movement practitioners between 2015 and 2017. The collaboration was kickstarted in the early stages of preparing an exhibition on the sculptor Auguste Rodin and his series of small sculptures in clay and in plaster that were posthumously called the Mouvement de Danse, made in about 1911-1913. These were all made by Rodin at the end of his long career and at a time when he was completely enthralled by dance, modern dance, particularly non-Western dance, Javanese dance, Cambodian dance, modern dancers of his time, basically anything that wasn't ballet. And they were works made in his studio directly from observation, as well as after hours of settling, directly from performers, dancers in the studio. And they were private works. So here are just a few slides of the exhibition that took place last year. 2 years ago. The series of works were a private pursuit. They were worked on in his studio and reworked on and reworked on, and only a very few had the privilege to come in the studio and see them. He didn't exhibit them, he didn't publish them. They were all posthumously given the title Mouvement Danse. And so this quote that I have up here is a response by one of his circle, a patron called Count Harry Kessler, when he visited Rodin's studio. And he talks about the glass case, and maybe that's what we had in mind when we designed a case specially for them in these slides that I show you. So these are the Mouvement Danse, I think almost all of them. And I wanted to approach the subject in a new way, by looking at the works through the medium of dance. This would require specialist input. It was through a suggestion by a colleague that I contacted the movement department at the Royal Central School of Speech and Drama, a world-leading acting conservatoire. And what followed was a series of initial meetings over several months. And this was the beginning of our collaboration to investigate Rodin's Mouvement Danse and the associated drawings from the perspective of movement analysis. Our group consisted of Ayse and Vanessa as two senior movement specialists and two movement graduates, Anna Marambio and Rachel Nucci, and myself. That was the core group. Our talk today is structured around three questions. What made this collaboration work? What were the fruits of our collaboration? And what advice would we offer to future collaborators, interdisciplinary collaborators? And we will also show a short film of about 8 minutes towards the end of our presentation. So the reason behind our collaboration in the first place was to help answer a set of questions. And one might say that this particular subject was ripe and particularly ripe for this kind of collaboration. Rodin's fascination with a variety of dance forms and performances, and the fact that he employed dancers and performers as models, he paid them to come to his studio, suggested a set of research questions that were based on the moving body. As a curator, putting on an exhibition involves coming up with the concept, selecting the best possible works, negotiating to borrow, and ideally asking some new research questions that reveal new information about the artwork or new approaches to understanding them. This was a good moment to enter a new terrain. One of the areas that we did do a lot of research on outside of this collaboration was a technical investigation. That was a really strong element of the exhibition. Very briefly, I can explain that the figures you have just seen in this slide, all of these and a few more that I'm not showing you, derive basically from Rodin's two figures who, for convenience purposes, a curator at the Musée Rodin and I called Alpha and Omega. These two figures are represented by this figure and this figure. He modeled them. Practitioners in his studio cut them up in order to make molds. The molds were then used to press mold further bits of clay, which then made individual parts. And those individual parts he reassembled into a variety of figures. So these are the molds in the plaster cast making up Alpha and the molds in the plaster cast making up Omega, the sort of standing figure and the kind of lunging forward figure. This is relevant, which is why I'm showing it to you now, but you don't need to have understood the entire process, and it's a bit more complicated than these two slides. Oh, sorry about that. But that is essentially the idea, that they were fragments and that they were reassembled.
So from a movement perspective, this was an opportunity for us to explore the sculptures freely with no fixed agenda. So we suggested going beyond the language of dance to investigate the broader terrain of movement. Movement teachers and movement directors observe and translate the human condition through the medium of movement for the benefit of professional and student actors. We also offer practical movement processes for an expressive and transformative craft to those who will become movement teachers and future movement directors. Our particular skills lie in observing, analysing and articulating movement, exploring and demonstrating through the body, reading the historic body through artefacts. So to our first question of this presentation, we have asked ourselves what made this collaboration and a wider collaboration work. The extended timeline and the rhythms of discovery were a key aspect of how this process unfurled. Our collaboration took place over a period of 2.5 years, from exhibition research through to delivery of the exhibition and the catalogue. Alongside the strongly driven curatorial timeline, Anna, Rachel, Vanessa and myself worked with a freer and looser time structure, during which we prepared what would ultimately become a 2.5 day, two half day movement workshop and a short film that we'll show you later on. In our joint sessions, we would discuss the findings of the curatorial research, then undertake movement explorations in the studio with a core group of researchers and sometimes with students from Central. In addition to this, we had several focused encounters with the works of art selected for the exhibition, including a visit to the Musée Rodin in Paris to examine the sculptures and drawings, and a handling session with the Rodin bronzes in the Courtauld Gallery's collection. This way of working together, crossing over on a number of very different activities over a relatively long period of time, allowed us to use our time together intensively and then benefit from the time apart to let things mull. From a movement perspective, the time apart was particularly useful for letting the information settle and filter through our regular movement practices before translating the research into movement investigations. An extended timeline also allowed us to respond dynamically and opportunistically to curatorial discoveries. For example, at various points in the process, we invited students with particular movement backgrounds to test ideas in the studio. One example of this dynamic and opportunistic response was the discovery in an erotic magazine of this photograph of an acrobatic dancer called Alda Morena. Alda was Rodin's model for the Mouvement de Danse series, and she's seen here in a pose that he would draw upon for the sculpture entitled Movement A, which is just next to it. This photo then led us to invite one of our movement students who had been an acrobat and an aerialist, so she had that in her body history. And here you can see her responding to movement B. She wasn't quite in that orientation. There we go, in that orientation. The rhythm of our meetings, P periods of intense work followed by periods of reflection was one of the most positive aspects of our collaboration because it built for processing information. One might worry that momentum would be lost, but we found quite the opposite was true. In fact, we gained an enhanced, finely textured understanding of the material. And back to Sasha.
Thank you. Another way in which this collaboration worked is that it allowed specific research questions to emerge from the general framework of dance of the period and the performing bodies of the models. Considering the subject matter was dance, and specifically dancers in the artist studio, I was intrigued about the possibility of finding out more about these works than was available to me as an art historian, such as, in particular, the experiential aspect of the movement. In other words, what could one find out together beyond what archival and historical sources can tell us and beyond the technical approaches to research? The movement practitioners' research questions developed out of the capacities and backgrounds of the individuals in the group. They realized that they could not look adequately at all the forms of movement that Rodin was interested in, or every practitioner he worked with, but what they could do was to call upon their diverse and shared movement trainings and their capacities for movement analysis. They also had a great pool of other movement skills and bodies amongst the movement students. A key moment in focusing on the subject was when the movement practitioners had a direct encounter with the works, as mentioned earlier, thus putting contextual considerations into the background. From then on, they focused more specifically on movement questions in relation to the material itself, allowing me to mediate the contextual considerations that were emerging from my concurrent research and that of my colleagues at the Musée Rodin. Thirdly, and finally, what made this collaboration work was our mutual recognition of disciplinary possibilities and parameters.
For movement practitioners working in theatre, subjectivity and felt experience are valuable. So we are adept at shifting between a range of points of view, deeply examining and inhabiting how another human exists. This offers another way of knowing, and the meeting point of our two disciplines was located between our subjective response and our understanding, and the curatorial drive to offer a historically based narrative that communicates to a broad audience. We made meaningful incursions from the partner discipline, but these always remained partial. The curator moved with us in the studio, and the movement people read contextual and academic works on Rodin and dance. However, the experience was most productive when we took our new knowledge and rooted it through our particular specialisms.
Moving on to our second question, sort of big question, what were the fruits of this collaboration? Well, the first was to find out things we couldn't find out on our own, quite simply. One of the key tasks was always going to be how to express the content that I had been learning about the movement, movement from the movement collaborators in the catalog for an intelligent but non-specialist reader and in the gallery for a hopefully intelligent but non-specialist museum visitor through the writing of labels and the placement of and juxtaposition of art objects. Towards the end of our collaboration, Vanessa, Ayse, and I met to critique and analyze my texts in relation to movements and postures. And I am ad-libbing, but that was not entirely painless because it turns out I didn't at all have the tools to describe, you know, the postures that a body is in. But movement teachers do this all the time. They analyze and describe movement because, from what I have understood, to teach a movement, it's necessary for them to describe the movement. So this was sort of part of their expertise. And I knew I wanted and needed help with the writing of the individual entries that went with each of the works that we had in the catalog. But I didn't necessarily know that what I had to ask were the following questions. What is happening here with the body? Why is this happening? You know, it was beyond the visual and into the experiential. Deconstruction of movement and creation of movement forms. This is what movement teachers do. And it was through this act of analysis and translation that I think we got quite a lot of fruitful results, which really the expression of which was the exhibition and the catalog. And they were extremely helpful in offering an exacting but plain physical vocabulary for reading the drawings and sculpture.
A second outcome was that we were able to navigate a space between the 1910 body and the body of today, unpacking some of the assumptions that a 21st century viewer might make about those sculptures. We offered ways of reading the body. For example, the photo of Alda Morena that you saw, Rodin's model, for the Mouvement de Danse series, provided us with many layers of information. It told us about her métier as a performer, her body story. It also tells us about the performance she's giving in the photograph. The story of the body tells us is both a historical story, i.e. the precise posture adopted, and a personal one, e.g. the individual's past or present injuries, the specificities of her morphology. When working with actors, there's always a meeting point between communicating the information of the historical body and connecting to a contemporary viewpoint. We need to register both in order to locate key movement principles that collapse the difference between the then and the now of a movement for the viewer.
Lastly, for me, the major outcome of this collaboration in terms of the fruits was the deepening of several hypotheses about the works, about models' relationships with Rodin in the studio, about the body and movement of the models. Through the dialogue between movement research and curatorial research, art historical research, we were able to confirm what art historians have always thought about this series, that they are of the order of preparatory movements. Physical preparation, warming up of the body, postures, acrobatic feats, rather than what might more typically call think of as dance, as having motion and engagement with space and traveling. In fact, when the sculptures were exhibited in the early days of the Musée Rodin, just a few years after Rodin's death, they were called, more accurately, I think, études de mouvement, or movement studies. Ayse and Vanessa, and I translated this for the catalog and everything. We gave this was a sort of taxonomy of movements, and we worked out families of movement. So now you have them all here. You might think they have strange names. It's simply that, well, it's a long history I can tell you more about, but they were posthumously just named A, B, C, D, E, F. Has to do with their casting in bronze history. So we have these different families, and it was very, very helpful to think of them this way. Here's uplift with A, B, and E. There is extension with, this one's called B plus because it doesn't have a head and it was found later. C, upside down, but also the other way around. G and H, also without a head. And you have to think these are non-positionable. I mean, they're not fixed in position, save one, which we'll show you. Twisting and gathering. This is I and I plus, and I can't remember which one that is, D. And then this one, leaping, which is perhaps the only one that really seems to have only one position, leaping or jumping. And then folding, which was never actually part of the series as it was commercialized and publicized and known until our exhibition.
By using movement environments, we have gained the following insights about the aspects of the moving body in the studio. So in our medium, the performing body's movements are most alive and most expressive in the moments of slippage and in the progression towards deepening. And we were moving and watching each other move, and it seemed at times as though an echo reached us from Rodin's creative space. We recognized ourselves as beneficiaries of the accidents and byproducts that are the real matter of expressive creation. Pre-moments to postures populate Rodin's drawings. Without consciously trying, we unearthed movements that the curators had seen captured in artworks beyond the corpus of the sculptures or drawings that we were studying. For a seasoned performer in the studio, there are some givens. Their performative instinct interferes with their human response. and their body is their livelihood, their most precious resource. So this creates a perfect storm, and it unleashes sets of creative negotiations that lay bare and expose the human being at the eye of this storm. The viewer no longer has their gaze orchestrated by the performance, rather the gaze is free to navigate an exposed body. As we watched Anna Morambio, our own practiced performer, prepare herself for an acrobatic posture, we felt close to understanding Morena's powerful personal input to the creation of these works. You will see Anna preparing at the beginning of a film that we will share with you in a moment. Moving in and out of these postures opens up the soft parts of the body, those parts normally secret. Mouth, genitalia, armpits, buttocks, neck. And we learned that if you set up certain postures, the movement of the limbs will inevitably reveal the core. Rodin famously played with the orientation of his sculptures in the latter part of his career, rotating them, placing them upside down, and he also reorientated his sketches. In the studio, we worked a lot with changing orientations. A body stretching, facing the floor, is not exposed, but when Rodin reorientates it, the sculpture of this, the position appears sexually explicit. Playing with orientation exposed the movers and also created new dynamics and differing narratives. So a resting posture in one orientation might offer the sense of elevation in another. As Sasha mentioned, the technical research for this exhibition revealed that Rodin created his mouvement de danse not by modelling figures in clay, but by assembling together clay casts of individual body parts to create a figure. This process of assemblage shines a light on how we, as viewers, receive the information contained in these sculptures. Rodin repurposed his various clay body parts to make new figures. This explains why, when we view them, we are kept in movement, rather than in the stasis of a whole body in resolved balance. We enter an unsettled rapport with aspects of conflict, dynamics, absences, transitions, subversions, impossibilities, uncertainties, incompleteness. So the conflicted dynamics, as in the case of these sculptures, as often is the case with actor movement, are the expressive dynamics. Our film shows us the number of movements required to make one posture. About 1 minute into the film, we will share with you in a moment, you will see Nicola perform movement A. You might be reminded that in Rodin's drawings, he captured micro adjustments of muscular activity. We now have a high-speed camera that can shoot up to 200 frames per second in slow motion, so we could get close to that level of detail. The moment of standing on one leg offers a strong physical experience of the micro adjustments. By embodying this moment, recording it on film, and revisiting the drawings after making the film, we are left with heightened respect for Rodin's acuity of seeing. After the film, which is 8 minutes in length, we would like to conclude with a few thoughts on what advice would we offer to future interdisciplinary collaborations. Thank you.